Welcome to the wonderful world of Stew. Sometimes you go online and all you want to do is see that latest hilarious kitty video. Am I right? Oh, look at that. Here comes the kitty. Uh-oh. Oh, here you go. Wait, what's that? Oh, a sneeze and the kitty reacted funny. Isn't that cute? But Facebook and Twitter are instead jammed up with progressive propaganda that make you want to become a kitty cat serial killer. That's where we come in. You send us what annoys you on social networks, and we get a little antisocial. If you listen to the media, you probably heard something like this from NFL player Chris Harris about the lack of black coaches being hired in the NFL. Just throwing the numbers out, the NFL players' minority makeup is over 75% of the league. The NFL head coaches' minority makeup is 12.5%. Here's how progressives rope people in an argument like that. Only like 10% of NFL coaches are black. That's outrageous. Hey, NFL, 1964 called, and it wants its segregation back. They immediately jump to racism, and we allow them to enact a stupid fairness policy so we don't look mean. In the NFL, it's called the Rooney Rule, and it requires teams with head coaching vacancies to interview minority candidates. The motivation is great. But let's take a closer look. Is there really a racism problem to solve anymore? Since this is Glenn Beck's network, I figure we should probably express this in candy. That just seems safe. This fishbowl contains the ratio of black players to white players in the NFL. Okay? Now, this other fishbowl here contains the ratio of white coaches to black coaches in the NFL. Obviously, these two are not equal. But let's take it a step further. Why? Why aren't they equal? Let me give you an example of why. This is one of the most productive wide receivers in the past 15 years. This is Terrell Owens. We gotta see some Terrell Owens. Sexy, sexy. Ooh, sexy. I almost thought it was a mirror for a second. That's actually Terrell Owens. This is one of the most productive head coaches in the past 15 years, Andy Reid. Not so sexy. I'm pretty sure those two jobs don't require the same skill set. What makes Owens a great wide receiver is completely useless to him as a head coach. In fact, it seems like one of the best qualifiers to be a good head coach is to be a mediocre player. And man, mediocre play is something us whiteys have totally nailed. Jim Harbaugh, mediocre quarterback, but a great coach. The 49ers' previous coach, Mike Singletary, was an all-time great player and a mediocre coach. So what are you saying? That African-Americans don't have the brains to coach? Not at all. And let me prove it to you using more fancy candy math. Here again is the ratio to black to white players in the NFL. Remember this one? Now, here are the ratio with the coaches. You remember these two, right? So why are we comparing these two, though? Why not compare coaches, right here, to the actual population of the United States? Still just rolling around back there. But do these look any different? Any evidence of racism here? Are these so crazy? If all races performed exactly the same, since blacks are about 12% of the population, they should have about 12% of the head coaching jobs. They currently have slightly less at 10%. Last year, they had slightly more at 16%. Over the past 15 years, here are the numbers of black coaches in the league. You'll see it's typically at or above the representation levels you would expect. And that sounds like, what's the word progressives always use? Oh, I don't know. Oh, yeah, fair. Where this falls apart, however, are the players. African Americans make up about 12% of the population. So why are they 70% of the players in the NFL? Especially when those are the jobs that every kid wants to get when they grow up. It's even more bizarre when you go by position. The same year the Rooney Rule was instituted, 98% of running backs were black. 98%. Hello. Ah, look, it's Peyton Hillis and Toby Gerhardt. White running backs haven't led the league in rushing since John F. Kennedy was president. Why? I mean, no one thinks owners are racist against whites. Conservatives and progressives come together and seem to agree that for whatever reason, blacks are just better at playing running back than whites. And to my African-American friends, I will pull no punches. We're kicking your ass at punting. Get over it. So let's unpack the progressive logic here for a second. You tell me if it makes sense. blacks can be better at whites at playing football. But whites can't be equally as good as blacks as coaching it? And I didn't understand that. And NFL owners hate blacks so much that they refuse to hire them as coaches, even with billion-dollar franchises on the line, while at the same time they will hire black players at nearly six times the rate of the general population? Have you even stopped to think about this at all? If your answer is no, congratulations, you're on Twitter and you're a progressive. The job you have should be based on merit, pure and simple. That's why conservatives and libertarians understand that hiring or firing someone based on the color of their skin is always wrong. Always. That's a message that everyone should agree with. But the media still portrays conservatives as haters. Why? I think it's packaging, personally. It doesn't matter what I say, but I'm a hideous, out-of-shape white dude with cholesterol as high as most movies taken at the box office. That's why we've created a new segment on The Wonderful World of Stew to make conservative positions more palatable. It's our attempt to get people to actually listen to the conservative perspective on things like global warming instead of just calling us earth haters. And there was only one way I could think of to do it. Enjoy. The monologue you are about to see is being performed by an actress. We have absolutely no friggin' idea if she believes even one word of it. But we don't care, because this is science.
I'd like to think that if I didn't dress like this, I could stop creepy guys like Al Gore from hitting on me. But that doesn't mean it's true. Likewise, the fact that so many people want hybrids to be a simple answer to lowering carbon dioxide emissions doesn't mean they are. And if you're going to tell me what I can and cannot drive, you'd better be solving a lot of big problems. Instead, they're creating new ones. The National Highway Traffic Safety Administration ran the numbers on what an increased focus on fuel efficiency would mean for the climate. In a 939-page report, they found that if successful, new regulations would shave one part per million from the carbon dioxide in the atmosphere by the year 2100. Wow. To give that some perspective, the doomsday scenario from the UN that is constantly being recited by the media is 970 parts per million, but that's just scientific nonsense to most people. Global warming is about temperature, right? Well, the new regulations will result in an estimated total decrease of 0.004 degrees Celsius by 2100. Oh, that's, of course, 0.0072 degrees Fahrenheit. In other words, it would save us 1/1600th of the doomsday level global warming we're constantly told to be so petrified of. In fact, the potential decrease is so insignificant that it's equal to only 1/45th of the margin of error in the past century's temperature change. Want to make this a little easier to relate to? Try this. Put your thumb and your finger about a centimeter apart. For those of you who understand the superiority of the good old English system, that's about 40% of an inch. Now, cut that distance in half. Now cut it in half again. Now again. Again. One more time. The remaining space between your thumb and your finger is about how much the proposed efficiency standards would decrease the allegedly forthcoming sea level rise. The grand total is 0.04 centimeters by the year 2100, which is equivalent to 1/15,200th and 40th of the sea level rise Al Gore warned us about in An Inconvenient Truth. The bottom line? The supposed solutions that progressives are offering us don't get any more effective as days go by. And Al Gore doesn't get any less creepy either.
We're keeping it all about the U.S. of A.
The only place on Earth
that has inspired the greatest amount of prosperity.
And we need to be reminded that it still exists.
Hey there, my name is Frank Bates. I just created a